Hello, my name is Marco Martínez, and I'm going to present the paper Differentiable Signal Processing with Black Box Audio Effects. This work was done together with Oliver Wang, Paris Smaragdis, and Nicholas Bryan, and it was conducted during my internship at Adobe Research. So first, to provide a context, audio effects are everywhere. They are widely used in various media, such as music, live performances, podcasts, films, or video games, and they're usually applied to manipulate different characteristics of sound, such as dynamics, frequency content, spatialization, and timbre of audio recordings. So the problem that we noticed is that audio production tools are hard to use. For example, at the left, you can see the interface of a real spacecraft, and at the right, you can see the interface of a professional audio plugin. So we thought that, yeah, using audio plugins shouldn't feel more intimidating than flying a spaceship. And it might feel like this sometimes because a lot of expert knowledge is required together with a steep learning curve. So the main goal that we have is a desire to simplify this process. And this can bring several applications such as automation of sound engineering tasks. For example, we can use neural networks to control audio effects directly to perform a desired high-level task. And the main research question that we are exploring here is, how do we automatically control audio effects to perform an audio production task? And as well, how to incorporate audio effects within a deep neural network and train Yonly, and how can we train such network to perform audio production tasks? For example, we explore whether a neural network can write parameter automation to make effects easier to use and more powerful, as we will show you later on. So this is a high level overview of our methodology. We introduced deep AFX, a new approach to differentiable signal processing that enables the use of arbitrary third-party black box audio processing effects within any deep neural network. So we have a deep learning architecture in which an encoder analyzes the input audio and learns to control audio effects that themselves perform the signal manipulation. Therefore, we want to explore how deep neural network can control audio effects and write parameter automation curves, as in a digital audio workstation. Most of the audio plugins are non-differentiable software. Thus, we are exploring a method based on finite difference to approximate the gradient of the plugins. For this method, we're going to consider the audio effects as a black box, since we only take input and output measurements. And for our application, we're going to approximate the gradient of the parameter theta. We believe that incorporating the domain knowledge from the audio plugins directly into the deep learning architectures cannot perform a state-of-the-art network and open up a wide range of applications in the fields of intelligent music production, effects and manipulation, and virtual and analog models, which are the applications that we're exploring in this paper. But as well, we believe this has applications in other fields, such as sound synthesis and sound separation. So first, before delving into the more technical part of our paper, let me show you the results of some tasks that we explore using our model. The first task that we're going to explore is tube amplifier emulation. The emulation of nonlinear effects or distortion effects is a highly researched field whose goal is to recreate the sound of an analog reference device, such as a tube amplifier. For this task, we're going to incorporate this multiband compressor into our network, and we will train our model to use 17 of its parameters. The results with the test set are the following. So first, this is the input, or dry audio. And this is the target from the analog reference device. This is the output of our model. So as you can listen, there are a lot of similarities and also some differences, but this is quite remarkable to obtain this type of result with just a multiband compressor in a field that complex mathematical models and neural network proxies have predominated. The second task is non-speech sound removal. Removing of non-speech vocal sounds such as breaths or lip smacks or voice pops is a common task performed by sound engineers. This task can be done manually by editing the audio waveform or by using audio processors. Both of these approaches can be time-consuming, they require expert knowledge, and to the best of our knowledge, the automation of this task has not been investigated yet. For this task, we're going to incorporate this multiband noise gate into our network, and similarly, we will train our model to use 17 of its parameters. The results with the test set are the following. So at the left, you can see the input. And if you notice in the spectrogram, the regions where the non-speech sounds are present in the input, whereas they are not present in the output of our model. But let's listen to a sample first. So this is the input.
We had made a great deal of way during the night, and were now lying becalmed about half a mile.
And this is the output of our model.
We had made a great deal of way during the night, and were now lying becalmed about half a mile.
So as you can listen, the non-speech sounds were successfully removed. Another advantage of our method is that we can check over time how the network is using these parameters, and we can display this as a parameter automation, such as is the case of digital audio workstations, and this looks like this. So this is how the network is using the 17 parameters across this audio segment, and as well, if we notice the regions where the bread and voice pops are present, this is where the network is moving most of its parameters. The last task is music mastering or music post-production, which is a process of enhancing a recording by manipulating certain characteristics of the mixture, such as the dynamics or frequency content. This manipulation is usually done by an experienced mastering engineer. For this task, we're going to incorporate three audio effects in series: a multiband compressor, a graphic equalizer, and a limiter. These give us in total 50 parameters. So the results with the test set are the following. Here is worth noting that the samples for this task were not loudness normalized, so as to evaluate loudness as part of this task. So the input or non-mastered track is the following.
Well, hey there, darling. I know it's late and the night's come along.
The master version by a professional mastering engineer is the following.
Well, hey there, darling. I know it's late and the night's come along.
And the output of our model.
Well, hey there, darling. I know it's late and the night's come along.
So as you could listen in the output and in the professional master version, the frequency, content, and dynamics have been modified from the input. We will come back to these results when we talk about the subjective listening test. So going back to our proposed methodology, this is Deep AFX. And as you can see, our model consists of a deep encoder and an audio effects layer. And we train the deep encoder to analyze the input audio and control the audio effect parameters in order to perform the desired signal manipulation. In this way, we only require an input and our target paired audio data, and we can train it in a supervised manner, end to end, and without the need of parameter labels for training. And as we mentioned before, the challenge that we have here is that we need to train our network with a non-differentiable layer which corresponds to the audio effects. So in order to achieve this, we're going to use a gradient approximation scheme that allows us to train this whole network within a standard auto-differentiation graph. This scheme that we're going to use is based on finite differences. So first, to provide some context, gradient approximation via finite differences can be briefly summarized as follows. So we have this function, which through the derivative is at theta. Finite differences is based on the backward and forward measurements of the function perturbed by a constant epsilon. So with these measurements, we can approximate the derivative in this manner. And therefore, one component of the gradient vector is defined by this equation. Thus, the gradient approximation is defined by the vector of partial derivatives with respect to each parameter, theta. So as you can see, finite differences perturbs only one direction at a time. And for a total of p parameters, it requires 2 times p function evaluations. This can be computationally expensive for even a small number of p, given that the function to be evaluated represents one or more audio effects. So as an alternative, we explore simultaneous permutation stochastic approximation, or SPSA, which is a method that has been proven to be an efficient gradient approximation method that can be used with a gradient descent for optimization. The SPSA gradient estimator is based on a random perturbation of all the parameters p at the same time, and one element of the gradient approximation vector by SPSA is defined with the following equation. So as you can see, the main differences are between the D vector and the delta vector. In the case of finite differences, the D vector is the unit vector for each parameter, whereas in the SPSA case, delta is a random perturbation vector. This random perturbation vector is sampled from a symmetric Bernoulli distribution. So we can see that SPSA disturbs all directions at the same time. And as well, in each iteration, the total number of function evaluation is 2. This is because the numerator in the second equation is identical for all the parameters p. So SPSA only requires 2 forward passes. One can argue that the random search directions do not follow the steepest descent, but we found among our experiments that over many iterations, errors tend to average and our method converges. So we have the problem that gradient approximation with finite differences is too slow and running all the effects represents a computational bottleneck. So our solution is to provide a gradient approximation scheme via SPSA with multi-threading, this using a multi-CPU setup. Another problem that we found is that all the effects are stateful. This means that output samples depend on previous input samples or internal states. Therefore, we cannot use random audio frames as input as illustrated in this diagram, since this will corrupt the state and yield unrealistic transients and artifacts. So our solution is to train the deep encoder to interact with the audio effect in the same way as an audio effect behaves in a digital audio workstation. As such, we feed consecutive non-overlapping frames to the audio effects layer. This ensures that there are no discrepancies between the behavior of the audio effects at training and during inference time. So coming back to our results, we conducted a subjective listening test where participants were asked to rate various samples according to the similarity relative to a reference sound. This is a sample processed by the sound engineer or a recording from the original analog device. So for the first task, these are the results, where the low anchor is an unprocessed sample. The mid anchor is the sample processed by a static preset of a nonlinear audio effect, and the hidden reference of as the high anchor. We also include a state-of-the-art model as baseline, CAFEX. So the CAFEX method ranks above our model, which is reasonable, considering that it corresponds to a state-of-the-art network for nonlinear emulation of audio effects. But our result for this task is still remarkable, however, since we're only using a multiband compressor in a field where complex mathematical models or deep neural network proxies have predominated. And these are the listening test results for the second task, where the low anchor is the unprocessed audio and the mid anchor is a static preset with a noise gate. So we can see that our model is rated almost as high as the human sound engineer, and also it's worth noting that the mid anchor is rated lower than the low anchor, which could indicate that using a static preset might be worse than doing nothing. The third task is music mastering. In this case, the mid anchor is peak normalization, and we also include a mastering version from a commercial well-known online mastering software, or OMS. Our model is rated above the online mastering service, which we consider the state of the art. Therefore, this shows that our approach can not only enable new automatic audio production tasks, but is high quality and comparable to a state-of-the-art commercial solution for automatic music mastering. So to finalize, these are the contributions of our paper. We provide a framework of differentiable black box audio plugins for deep learning applications. This, using a scheme based of fast gradient approximation via SPSA with multi-threading, and also training networks with stateful black boxes, delay invariant loss function, and training procedures for audio plugins in series, and more information about this can be found in the paper. We can conclude that we present an AI that enables new automatic audio effect tasks comparable or better than commercial solutions and achieves near human performances. Audio samples and code can be found in the following link. Thank you for watching this video.